Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. It's good to be here, isn't it? Let's start our service by singing number 422. We're marching to Zion. Sounds like we're soldiers. Sometimes weary, sometimes wounded, but we keep on marching. I thought the pianist had been raptured. Good to see her. 422. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we are marching to Zion. Sometimes the roads gets a little weary and rugged, and we're tired, we get discouraged, we want to turn back. There's no turning back, Father. Where would we go? What could we do without you? You are everything to us, Father. So let us focus our attention on you. What you want to teach us this Sabbath, glorious, beautiful Sabbath morning. We long forward to being with you, Father, very soon. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Good to see you, many of you here this morning. Even though a little cold, but the sun was out and was beautiful driving to church this morning. So good to see you all this morning. This morning, I'm going to share with you the division that our 13th Sabbath offering is going to be going to. That is the East Central Africa Division. So I'm going to share a little bit information about that division. And also I'm going to share with you a mission trip that I went with the Highlandry Academy a few years ago to Kenya. Kenya is part of the East Central Africa Division, and the division office actually is located in Kenya, Nairobi, Kenya. So I'm going to share that with you briefly this morning. How many countries do you think East Central Africa Division, how many countries are comprised of that division? Any idea? But yeah, I came up with a nine, but there's other couple country names that I couldn't recognize, so I didn't even put it here. But these are the some of the countries that are part of the East Central Africa Division: Burundi, Congo, Ethiopia, Kenya, Rwanda, Somalia, South Sudan, Tanzania, and Uganda. So those are part of the countries that part of the East Central Africa Division. And this is the map of that East Central Africa Division. So there's another division right below that East Central Africa Division. So this is the picture of that. So how many members reside in that division? How many Seventh-day Adventist Church members? The population is about 419 million, but our church membership is 4.5 million. I think this either second or first. I think the Inter-American Division might be a little bit more, but this is one of the largest divisions in our church. So 4.5 million membership. Kenya has over a million membership. You have Congo, 713, Ethiopia, Rwanda, almost a million members there. And another big country, Tanzania, has 837,000 members. So that's quite large division. And our 13th Sabbath project for this quarter, these are the some of the projects that the funds will be going to. It will be nursing school dormitory in Rwanda and faculty housing at the university in Rwanda, and also youth training center in Uganda, and multi-purpose hall in Ethiopia, and dormitory school for deaf in Kenya, and multi-purpose hall in Tanzania. So those are some of the projects that will receive 13th Sabbath offering. So right now I'm gonna share with you the mission trip that Highlandry Academy took in 2018. I don't think I shared that with you this, so I'm gonna share that. This school is located north of Nairobi. We had to pass through the equator to get to this place, and town nearest town is Meru, and this school is Kirua Adventist Primary and Secondary School. So this is the school that we went. And before I share with you, I'm going to read a couple Bible text. It says Matthew 25:40. Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it for me. And Proverbs 14:31 says, he who oppressed the poor taunt his maker, but he who is gracious to the needy honors him. And Matthew 10:42, and if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones, because he is my disciple, truly I tell you, he will never lose his reward. So these are some of the Bible texts that we share with our students before we went on our mission trip to Kenya. But because of the airlines that trying to getting to Kenya, we had to have a layover in Amsterdam, Holland. We had about 7-8 hour layover. And so we decided that instead of just sitting in the airport for that long, we're gonna take a little trip out. So we went out and we hired the tour guides, and they gave us a quick tour of the Amsterdam. And also they took us to the place that they make cheese. And so we had a little lesson on how they make cheese. So this is all the cheese that they had. So this is some of the Amsterdam. And then we finally arrived to Nairobi, Kenya, after some 20-some hours of traveling. Was very tired. And then we had to hop onto the bus. And then we went to the East Central Africa Division headquarters, where we stayed there for a few days. So this is their Sabbath morning. We got up. We arrived there Friday late night, and then Sabbath morning we got up and we went to the cafeteria, and they served us breakfast there for us, and we had a church. And then afternoon we kind of walked around the campus of the East Central Africa Division headquarters. Pretty large area, and there's a lot of different institutions were there. One of them was Maxwell Academy. This is the boarding academy for that area, and many of the missionary kids attend school there too. And also there's a university that were located right inside of that campus. So it was very beautiful campus. And this is the guest house. They have several guest houses like this throughout the campus. And this is one of the guest houses that we stayed Friday night and Saturday night. And early Sunday morning, we got ready and we headed out to our work site. It was about 6-7 hours of drive to get to where we were supposed to go. And I think you see your son there, right? Ben is there. Yeah, he was part of our mission trip. After several hours, we passed right through the equator, and so we had to stop and take a picture. And I don't know if you know, but those there who traveled, if you go to the country that is right at equator or near equator, sunrise and sunset is very same every single day, 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. That's their sunrise and sunset, no matter what the season. And so it's pretty easy, and we liked that the sunset is fairly early, because then kids can, you know, go out or do things. I mean, after when it's dark, the whole country is really dark. There's not that many places that is lighted area, so it's easy to keep kids inside and nice to supervise them. So this is the school that we were going, and so we traveled about 6-7 hours up north, and then we got to the place. Now, when I used to go to mission trip many long time ago, mission trip is you go to the place and then you stay in the either dormitories or school classrooms or things like that, and we had to bring a sleeping bag, and we got eaten by the mosquitoes, you know, and wasn't really the greatest lodging facility. But nowadays, when you go to mission trip, you get to stay in a hotel, which is pretty nice. I wasn't complaining. And they also had mosquito nets in the room, and we slept actual bed and a hotel restaurant that fed us the breakfast and dinner, and they packed us lunch to go to work. So it was really nice lodging facility. When we finally arrived to school, all the students knew they were coming, and they were all out there waiting for us. And this is not even before we went in. And then look at this, all the students, every one from the school came out and waited and welcoming us to the work site. And the work that we were supposed to do is that they had a dormitory, but they really didn't have a good bathhouse facility where they had showers and bathrooms and things like that. So we were going to build a bathhouse for the girls' dormitory, which is going to be attached to their currently existing dormitory. So this is what our work was supposed to be. And when we got there, they already had a foundation laid and about 3 rows of the bricks already in place. And so we were to finish the rest of that during that 1 week that we were there to work. So this is a principal and then student association leader from the school came and gave us the welcoming words for us. And then shortly after that, we started working and laying bricks. And many of the students never done this before, and so they were learning as they were doing. And then as you can see, Horsker was there watching us to work. So it was quite intense to trying to do our work and trying to learn what we need to do, and then they were watching us to do. And so this is our daily work. A lot of moving the bricks and mixing the cement and then laying the brick. And we went through a Maranatha group, and they do a really good job. They hire professional workers, the local workers. So there's about four or five of them. And so they were working alongside with us so that there was someone that knew what they were doing, that the things, building would stand there for a long time. So these are some of the work that we did, as you can see. And because we're in a construction site, everybody had to wear hard hat, so that was a requirement. And time to time, we get to take a little break and take pictures with the kids. They love taking pictures with us, and so this is what they did. So this is a kind of building on your right side is their currently existing dormitory, and then left side is the bathhouse they were building, one that was tarped around. And after 2-3 days of work, we were progressing pretty good to the almost top of that roof, as you can see. And then, not only outside, but inside, we had to make the stars, the walls for the separation for the showers and restroom portion of that. And one of our students, he brought a drone, and he took a lot of pictures and video by using that. And the local students, they were very interested in what, this thing was. And then they all came out to watch that. And then he kind of flew down really low towards them, and they got scared, and they started running away after the storm came too near them. So this is almost towards end of the week. And also during afternoon, we took time, and we did the vacation Bible school with them. So this is all the students that came out to the, I think this is the church and chapel and all together. And this is some of the scenes as we are driving back and forth to our work site and then our hotel. One of the entertaining things is that many days, the monkeys and different animals come near to us, and so as you can see, our students, they do bananas and different fruits, and so this is what happened. So towards end of the week, we were almost, we basically finished all our walls around the building and the inside also. One of the interesting is that the dormitory that they are currently using does not have running water. So all the students, there's a certain time during the day that they are come and they take all the buckets, and they have to walk some distance to get the water for the whatever that they need. This was basically their current bathroom. As you can see, was not really a great situation. And this is their toilet. And so our job was to build a nicer bathroom and bathhouse for them. This was their inside the dormitory, as you can see, muddy, and was not the greatest place. This is me and trying to cut the blocks so that we can fit into the place. We did a lot of walking, basically. We had to move the blocks from one location to the actually, building and mixing cement. And also we have to sift the sand so that little rocks and things like that doesn't get mixed into the the cement mix. I don't remember exactly how many went, but I think it was about 12, 13 students and three chaperones that we went to this trip. This is their classrooms. Also, is not the the nicest classroom, but they are seems to be happy. And this is their cafeteria. Really, compared to our cafeteria, they had to use the wood to fire up, and it's very difficult cooking and all that. And then they serve every students there. And so basically the students every day, what they got is the bowl of, I don't know, stew or soup or something like that, a lot of beans and things. Yoyok? Okay, so this is everybody. And interesting is that every student had to bring their own bowl. They did not provide. So everybody brings their own and they line up and then they get one scoop of this, and this was their lunch for them. And whenever we get there in the morning, many students line up entrance of the school, and just they wanted to see us and welcoming us there. So this is some of the school, they wash their clothes and they hang, and this particular day was raining, but they still had a clothes out there. And then last day, Friday afternoon, we were to dedicate a building. And so when we, that morning we went to visit another school, and then when we came that afternoon, the Pathfinder group of the school, they lined up and they kind of escorted us into the place, and they had everything nicely set up, and they had some ceremony to dedicate the building. This was the principal, Mr. Borges, so he's thanking them and everything. These are some local contractors that were hired to do the work for with us. And we got to cut the ribbon, and then everyone, all the students, they went into that. This is the bathhouse, the completed one. They didn't have any lights. They're going to do that later, but this was, the completed final product. And so they were all going in there and singing and happy. And the next day, the last Sabbath, we were there for two Sabbaths. We went to some distance. It's called Shamburu Tribe. It's quite a distance from the main city area. And there, Maranatha had a one-day church building. So this is a one-day church building. And we got to worship with the locals there. They were so happy to see us. And everybody wanted to take pictures with us, so me there taking pictures with them. And then ladies, they had a very colorful dress. Everybody wore a very colorful dress. They came out and thanked us and all the things that we did. And they also took us to, a few of us, they took us to show their, house. This is where they live. And so basically some sticks and our kind of cardboard boxes and tarp and things like that, basically that's how they build this little house. And so this is where they live. And they invite us into their homes. So right there, they basically are sleep on their floors. And this is their kitchen where they cook. And, so many of our students who actually, saw this, they came out very thankful that, we have a lot of nice things back home. And this is the, that afternoon, after spending time with them in the morning, that afternoon we came back to the school, and then we did the final VBS program with the school students. Many of them, even though it's a Saturday non-school day, they came back to school. So we got to have a finer VBS school with them. So as Mark 16:15 says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations. And Advent's church is built on mission. Our commission comes from the Christ, who told us to go into all the world and preach the gospel to our creation. And sharing God's love around the world is like a vehicle. It needs a fuel to propel. And our mission offering that we collect on 13 Sabbaths are the fuel that prepares almost every aspect of our outreach. So let us remember that when we give our offerings, especially 13th Sabbath offering, that it's going to the places like that to finish the God's work. We have a few minutes, and so I'm going to share with you one. The student that who brought the drone, he put together a nice video, so we're going to share that with you to close that. Happy birthday. Asante in Kenyan, Swahili means thank you. So that's the last thing, and that was one word that we learned. And then the school gave us each one a nice little local craft kind of gift, and I still have that in my office. You know, sometimes when we go on a mission trip, we think that we're helping others, but many times we come out learning a lot of new things and appreciations and how God has blessed all of us, and even though they don't have much, they are very happy, and they always praise the Lord, and they come to church, you know, with, you know, happy and smiling, and so, you know, there's a lot of appreciation that we learn from them, that, you know, even though we have a lot, many times we come to church, and maybe not really wanting to be here, look like, you know, not happy, but they are very appreciative, and also they wanted to talk to us and spend time and take pictures, and many of our students exchanged their, whatever, the social media, you know, thing, even though they don't have a lot, you know, they said we're, you know, some of the students knew how to get on the internet and things like that. So I just wanted to share that with you, and now we're going to divide for lesson studies, one right here in main sanctuary, and then one out hallway and downstairs, that you receive God's blessing through the study of the Bible. Thank you so much. Have a happy Sabbath.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Brother Andy, for sharing that. My Brother Andre, for sharing that with us. And it's right on cue for the message, the Sabbath school today, the idea of giving, offering to God the blessings that he has given us. And in this case, you are offering your time along with all the other missionaries. So thank you for sharing that. Today, we are on the fourth lesson of the year. Can't believe the month is almost over already. Isn't that crazy? Like how fast it's going. But it's been a blessing. I've been away for the last week. Shanoi and I and the family, we did a trip pretty much to Texas. And so it was a blessing. We went to the Ad Agra conference, and that was such a blessing. That was my first time. So for those who have never been, it's worth going next year. They're going to be in Florida next year, so please register and make a trip. So managing for the master, you know, the idea of stewardship, that everything we have, God has blessed us with it, and God has given it to us so that we use it to the best of our abilities. And he's given us talents and gifts and a mental capacity to be able to do so. So today we're looking at how offerings how we deal with the offerings for Jesus. That's pretty much what the title is. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your many blessings. Thank you for bringing us to Sabbath school. Thank you, Lord, for all the missionaries all across the world, which is sharing your blessings to others who are not as fortunate. And Father, that is your desire, and that's why we give we return our tithe and our offerings, Lord, so that the work can continue to be spread across the world. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So we all know that we should return our tithe and our offering, and we know that it's not really paying it, right? Because we're just returning it. Why? Because David says in Psalms 24, verse 1, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Psalms 24, verse 1. And this was on my mind this week because this is the children's memory verse. It says, now therefore, our God, we thank thee and praise thee. Let's praise your glorious name. But who am I and what is my people that we should be able to offer so willingly after this sort? For all things come of thee, and of thine own we have given thee. And what really touched me from this verse as it goes towards offerings is that they were able to give an offering. You know, because you could be in a situation where you want to give, but you don't have it. You know, we're pretty fortunate in America. Most of us probably never had that situation. But there's times where you want to give to something, but you don't have. And not only that, they also had the willingness of giving. So those two things jumped out at me. You know, all things come of thee. I kind of understand the idea God provides everything. But, you know, I could see where David's heart was when he was sharing this. You know, like, who am I and who are my people that we're able to have this resource to give back to this temple that they were building to God? And not only did they have it, but the hearts of the people were at the right place. You know, a lot of times in the Old Testament, they were at the wrong place. You know, but when we look at this particular situation, and even a situation with Moses when they were giving back, we see, yes, they got it right, right? You know, they weren't perfect people, just like we're not perfect people, but that really jumped out that they were able to offer so willingly after this sort. And so may we be willingly and able to be able to return our offerings to God as well. But I was wrestling with this. And in fact, the idea of tithe and offering is one of those things that I just always thought was the church is doing it for money. This was pre-Christ. This was before I became a Christian. Like, this is a business. You know, they're just doing this because they, you know, you hear these stories of these like mega churches and these pastors who have jets and stuff like that. So my idea of Christianity was like this money-making scheme, you know. And so before I became a Christian, I was like, I'll never be a Christian because that's what it's all about. You know, just basically making the pastors rich. And then, you know, someone invited me to church and I started going to church and I didn't even think about that. And then when I gave my heart to Christ, I just easily give. Because once your hearts change, all those things don't really matter. And so we're talking about the motivation for giving, right? This, I think, is Sunday's part of the lesson. The title is Motivation for Giving. You know, because when your heart's right with God, you don't have to, it shouldn't be something where you feel coerced or forced to do. It just happens naturally. And at that time, before Christ, that would have been a big struggle. So I just wanted to point that out. And I was wrestling with the lesson. I was like, yes, we know we're supposed to give, but this can be misconstrued. Like, you know, like it's all about just, you know, giving and then God is going to bless you. You know, it's kind of, it could be one of those things looked at as a prosperity gospel, right? Like, you know, if you sow enough, God will give you enough. And we know God let the sun shine on the just and on the unjust. Surely God don't need our money. Right? So I just wanted to, as I was wrestling with it, I was like, Lord, what should I talk about? And these are some of the questions that came from that thought. How are you giving to appease or to satisfy the wrath of an offended God? You know, these are some wrong reasons that I put together for giving or returning. You know, like, are you giving because if you give to God, then he will be merciful to you and he won't burn you in hell or whatever. You know, like, is your motivation to try to appease God's wrath? You know, and as I was wrestling with that, the Holy Spirit popped these scriptures in my head. And I'm going to ask a few volunteers to help me read some of these verses. The idea of how Saul was returning or giving and how Cornelius was giving and what the motivation was between these two people. So can I have a volunteer to read 1 Samuel 15, verse 13 to 23, and then we're going to look at Cornelius in Acts 10, 1 to 4. It's 1 Samuel 15, 13 to 23, first.
1 Samuel 15, starting with verse 13.
Thank you.
And Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said unto him, Blessed be thou of the Lord. I have performed the commandment of the Lord. And Samuel said, What meaneth then this, the bleating of the sheep in mine ears, and the lowing of the oxen which I hear? And Saul said, They have brought them in from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God, and the rest we have utterly destroyed. Then Samuel said unto Saul, Stay, and I will tell thee what the Lord hath said to me this night. And he saith unto him, Say on. And Samuel said, When thou wast little in thine own sight, wast thou not made the head of the tribes of Israel, and the Lord anointed thee king over Israel? And the Lord sent thee on a journey and said, Go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they be consumed. Wherefore then didst thou not obey the voice of the Lord, but didst fly upon the spoil and didst evil in the sight of the Lord? And Saul said unto Samuel, Yea, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord, and I've gone the way which the Lord sent me, and have brought Agag, the king of the Amalek, and have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But the people took of the spoil, sheep and oxen, the chief of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God in Gilgal. And Samuel said, Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams.
All right, thank you very much for reading that so clearly. All right, anybody wants to explain what's the motivation here for keeping the animals for sacrifice? You guys know this story well. One thing I like about Sabbath school is that we could go back and forth, right? It's supposed to be interactive. So anybody wants to chime in on their thoughts on this? The motivation, because we're talking about motivation for giving. What was Saul's situation here? I think Sister Paula had something to say. Yeah, he kept the good animals, right? The ones that are weakly, he was like, we could kill those so we could partially obey God. And what did God tell him to do? Wipe them all out. Brother Andy.
They kept the good sheep so they could use them for sacrifice. That way they wouldn't have to use their own.
Yeah. So what's the motivation there?
Greed.
Yeah. And what was the command? Just to destroy them, right?
Men, women, children, all the animals have nothing alive there.
Exactly. So there was a purpose behind that, you know, and we could go into that. I don't want to take a lot of time into it. And before this mission, even, you know, a battle came, and I believe it was the Philistine in chapter 13 that was setting themselves up against them. And Saul was supposed to go to Samuel to get Samuel to ask God how we should approach the situation. But Saul went straight in and sacrificed and did everything. He didn't have patience, and God wasn't happy about it. And God gave him another chance, and this was the chance that he got to, you know, to obey, to repent, and do what was right. And he went in there, and instead of wiping them out, like he said, he basically did what he wanted to do. And it was greed. He saved back what he wanted to save. And then even the king that God told him to wipe out, he kept alive as well. And it's interesting, in verse 15 and verses 21, he threw the soldiers under the bus. It says, And Saul said, They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared, in that case, the soldiers spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice unto the Lord. And in verse 21, again, he says, And the people took the spoil and the sheep and the oxen and chief of the things which should have been utterly destroyed to sacrifice unto the Lord. So you see that we can disobey God, live a life of oppression and whatever, and just think that we can give to the cause of God and that should be able to appease God. Was God pleased with that decision? No, he said to obey is better than sacrifice. And you know, sometimes in the past when I would talk to people, you know, about, you know, Christianity or just different topics like that, they would say, well, I'm a good person. I give to such and such charities. I do this and I do that. You know, but if you're doing that because you think you're going to be right in the sight of God, that could be a deception. So I just wanted to bring out something on the negative side. Now we're going to look at something on the positive. So Acts chapter 10, verse 1 to 4. If we can have a volunteer read that one. All right, my brother in the back here.
There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian Band, a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming to him and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, What is it, Lord? And he said unto him, The prayers of thine alms come up for memorial before God.
Amen. Thank you, Daniel. So we see the difference here. So now this guy's giving, Cornelius, seems like he's a Roman person, and he was giving to the cause of God. But now I'm going to bring it back to the floor. What's the motivation here with this person compared to Saul? So Saul, child of God, an Israelite, leader, a king of Israel, and then we have a centurion who is referred to in the book of Acts 10. What's the difference in the motivation here? Yeah, that word fear there is like reverence, right? Like he recognized God's goodness. He reverenced him, and because he loves him, he was giving to the cause, you know, and he was giving a lot. In that case, I believe that he sold his land, right? And it was giving it to the blessing of the church at the time. All right, so those are some things that I wanted to bring out, but there's a few other questions that I put out there. Have these scriptures here. Hosea 6:6 says, For I desire mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offering. So in our giving, let it be because of the right reasons, right? Not because God's angry and we're trying to appease him. And so I put this Old Testament scripture, God desire mercy and not sacrifice and the knowledge of God more than burnt offering. The idea that God wants us to be merciful even as our Father in heaven is merciful, right? But not because we're trying to appease him. And in John 17, verse 3, it says, And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. So again, knowing God is more important. You know, seek ye first the kingdom of God is more important than what we can offer to God. Because guess what? Everything that we have is from him anyway. All right. Now, another motivation that could be wrong is, are you giving so that you can receive some kind of miraculous power? And we know the story in Acts chapter 8, verse 18 to 25, where this brother by the name of Simon saw the apostles doing these miracles and basically is like trying to pay them to receive that power. And let's take a look at that. Can I have a volunteer read Acts 8, verse 18, all the way to 25? Not very long. Acts 8:18 to 25. Thank you.
Acts 8:18 to 25. And when Simon saw that through the laying on of the apostles' hands of the Holy Spirit was given, he offered them money, saying, Give me this power also, that anyone on whom I lay hands may receive the Holy Spirit. But Peter said to him, Your money perish with you, because you thought that the gift of God could be purchased with money. You have neither part nor portion in this matter, for your heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore, of this your wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are poisoned by bitterness and bound by iniquity. Then Simon answered and said, Pray to the Lord for me, that none of these things which you have spoken may come upon me. So when they had testified and preached the word of the Lord, they returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel in many villages of the Samaritans.
Amen. What can we take away from that? Any comments on that one? So we see his motivation was power. Yeah. Uh-huh. Exactly. And so what did the apostles want? Why did they rebuke him? Or corrected him? That word is a little strong. They want to make sure that he learned the right way, right? Like, this is not something that you purchase. The power that we receive from God is not something that can be buy or sell, right? This is something that you receive as a gift. And his heart was not in the right place because he basically envied the apostles and what they were doing and wanted to have that power for himself so he could, you know, go around with the power, if you will. So God wants us to give to his cause, not because we're trying to receive some power to be able to do miracles. And that was a scripture that came to my mind as well. And then the final one is, are you giving because you want to be saved? Like, you could purchase your salvation. We see for years that, unfortunately, the church has used salvation to make money, right? Think about purgatory and different things like that. It has been used to build up huge buildings and structures and hierarchy and so on and so forth. Especially if you travel in Europe, you'll see, you know, the remains of the Holy Roman Empire, you know, and a lot of that was lies, because the Bible tells us in Romans 6 verse 23 that the wages of sin is death, but the what? The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. So it's not something that can be purchased. I know for us here, we all know this, but I like to review these things because it's important, and somebody may be watching and never heard this before. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And he continues, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. So we see that it is the gift of God. It's not something that you can earn, not something you can purchase. It is something that God is willing to give to us because he loves us with an everlasting love. He's willing that everybody should save and none should be perished. But good works should follow as a response to God's love. We love him because he first loved us. And so it should be that we're giving because we are in gratitude to God. We appreciate what he did, and we're offering ourselves, our time, our resources, and our money to the cause of God. So on Sunday's lesson, the last two paragraphs, I like what it said here. It says, our offerings are an evidence of our willingness to sacrifice self for God. Making an offering can be a deeply spiritual experience, an expression of the fact that our lives are wholly surrender to God as our Lord. To us, as an English idiom says, it is putting our money where our mouth is. You can say you love God, but generous offerings help reveal and even strengthen that love. An offering comes from the heart, or our heart, that trusts in a personal God who constantly provide for our need as he sees fit. That summarized it really well. But I didn't want it to be that, you know, it's all about offering, and we're not looking at, you know, some poor reasons to give an offering. So I pointed out some of those verses. All right, so we're going to move forward. Any questions or comments? Okay. All right, so in 2 Corinthians 9, which the lesson tells us to look at, chapter 9, verse 6 to 7, it says, remember this, and I used the easy read version because I thought it brought it up. Remember this, the one who plants few seeds will have a small harvest, but the one who plants a lot will have a big harvest. Each one of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give. You should not give if it makes you unhappy or if you feel forced to give. God loves those who are happy to give. And I thought Paul nailed it there, right? Like, just want you to know this principle, that if you give a lot, you'll receive a lot. And he says in a different place in the gospel that you are better to give than to receive. And he talks about if you give, it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, and so on and so forth. So we see that this principle of giving a lot, you are blessed with a lot, both. And then if you're going to give, you should give from the heart. All right, so I'm going to open up this to the floor. We're a little too quiet. what portion of our offering should we give? That, I believe, is Monday's lesson. We have a lot of seasoned Christians in the house of God today. What portion of the offering should we give? Okay. She said, it depends on how much you have, you said?
How much you have.
Mm-hmm.
And what the need is.
Okay.
I mean, there are times that you're going to have to sacrifice just a little more.
Mm-hmm. For a cause.
For a cause, or I think even helping neighbors.
Yes.
And they're with when there's a personal tragedy or problem, sharing with them.
Absolutely.
That's still giving to God's cause.
Absolutely. I like where you're going with that. Anybody else want to add to it? I have Debbie's hand over here.
I know we talked about this a little bit last week. I maybe stole into your place here a little bit, maybe, but I brought the tithe envelope up last Sabbath, and you know, it gives a suggestion of the guidelines on there, the tithe 10%, which is not negotiable.
Yeah.
But then it says the local church budget 4-7%, Chesapeake Advance 1-2%, world budget 2-3%. So what all that is telling us is that, is like Miss Laura has said, whatever the Lord impresses us and is asking us to give. But it's something that we need to do prayerfully, too.
Right.
And ask him. And not only that is, you know, which areas that we want to submit it to. But it's very clear in the church guidelines and in the, on our tithe envelope that there is a thank offering above and beyond. And that's what these are ours, for how much the Lord has blessed us. So if we sit and say, I've never really not received any blessings. I mean, I can't walk. I can't eat. I can't, you know, I can't even swallow or talk. You know, I really don't need to give anything.
Mm.
But every time our heart beats is a blessing from God. Every breath we take is a blessing from God. Every time we blink our eyelashes, it's a blessing from God. We can't do any of that.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you guys for both commenting on that. Yeah, so it should be, like the scripture said, the previous scripture said, from the heart. We know the tithe is a set amount. Oh, thank you. The tithe is a set amount, but the offering here should be from the heart. Deuteronomy 16:17 agrees with this. It says, each man should give as much as he can. He should decide how much to give by thinking about how much the Lord has given him. So this should be out of response to God's love and blessing and from the heart. And what I like what my sister here said was that, yes, we bring our offerings to church and we give towards the cause of church, because surely we want to take care of our home, right? Like, we want to make sure our lights are on, that we can have a fellowship meal, all the different things that we need for the operation and the local work that is being done here. But we can also give to our neighbors outside of church. People will never put foot in those doors, right? And by doing that, you're preaching the gospel without even opening up the scriptures, right? And then also giving to missions, you know, and different missionary endeavors that are happening all across the world. Now, I'm going to open the floor up again. What are some good missionary endeavors that we can give an offering to? So that way, we can kind of hear what other people are giving to or things that they know about.
First of all, I remember reading a story a few years ago. This businessman, he started by double tithing. He would give 10% and then 10% offerings. And business grew, and then he increased that to 30%,
yes,
40%, 50. He went up all the way to 90. He said, I'm going to live on 10%, give 90 to God. And business was just boom. He kept on growing.
Yeah.
Now, their needs that may not be on the budget. For instance, my wife shared with me, she's down in Mexico.
Yeah.
She's coming back sometime this week. I don't know. I'll find out when she gets home. Just kidding.
You better know.
A neighbor of my mother-in-law, a young woman, her husband left her with two kids, And this girl works very hard to make ends meet, cleaning houses. Mm. My wife cooked them a meal, and they were just, the kids, the reaction of the children was just astonishing that they hadn't had a decent meal in a long time, it seemed like.
Yeah.
I think my wife gave them a little money. So we need to pray, Lord, where can I make a difference?
Absolutely.
The times when I pray that prayer and someone's name comes to mind, and sure thing, there was a need, and yes. Same thing happens to my wife. She, you know, sends money to someone and said, you know, I was praying that God would send me X number of dollars. I could buy that medicine that I needed so badly.
Right.
These things are not in the budget, but we need to be aware of those things.
Amen. Thank you for sharing that. You know, like God wants, you had a hand? Go ahead.
And I've been on a number of Maranatha trips that looked like what we saw on the screen here.
Yeah.
And I remember one, our bus taking us to our project stopped in a little village. And here, this lady was sitting on the dirt, making her porridge on a rock. And her oven was like a teepee.
Yeah.
And that was her kitchen. It makes you very selfish when you come home and look at all that we have. And, you know, if the cupboard's not clean or the counter's not clean, we fuss. And they don't even have counters and cupboards.
Right. Yes. It makes you, like Brother Andrew said at the end, like when you, or somewhere in his talk this morning, basically that you're more blessed to give than to receive. When you offer that time, you know, like your heart's touched, you recognize how abundantly you have been blessed. And you're happy. You become more content with what you have because you have given. Yeah, and just to follow up what you were saying, my brother, too, is like God wants to give us a blessing. He wants to give us a testimony. And sometimes we're so stingy that we never go out on a limb. We never sacrifice, you know, to offer something to somebody else and receive that blessing. Because I don't know about you guys, over the last 10 years to me just went like a blink. Right? And before you know it, your life is like gone. And then when you look back at it, you know, you want to have that satisfaction in knowing that you have listened to God's will, you know, and that you were able to give to God's cause. Go ahead, brother.
There are times when we look at the budget and we say, I can't give anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, we break the budget rules. We give more than we thought we could. And the blessings are just astounding.
Right.
I remember one time I was sitting at a church, and there was an appeal for a lady. She had been abused by her husband. She was in a shelter. She needed money badly to, you know, be on her own. And I remember everything I had in my pocket. I was struggling with work as a subcontractor, being self-employed.
Yeah.
I just felt compelled by the Holy Spirit. I put my hand in my pocket. I gave everything I had.
Amen.
That week I had like $2,000 plus in contracts that I, you know, work that I did. The best week I think I ever had.
Amen.
So being aware, being in touch with the Holy Spirit, where would you want me to make a difference today?
Amen.
I think that's a key to giving.
Amen. And it's coming from the heart. It's coming from a relationship with Christ. On Monday's lesson, paragraph 2, I like what that said. It said, how could we ever repay God for all his blessings to us? The simple answer is that we never could. It seemed that the best we could do is to be generous with the cause of God and in helping our fellow human being. When Jesus sent out his disciples on a missionary trip, he told them, freely you have received, freely give. Our offering contribute to the development of a Christ-like character. We are thereby changed from selfishness to love. We are to be concerned for others and the cause of God as Christ was. And so, you know, that should be the motivation. And honestly, we're truly blessed when we do that. And God will never ask us to do something that he himself have not done. He has given everything, right? He gives us his only begotten son. He gives us the angels. He gives us life. He gives us the Holy Spirit. He became a man and humbled himself, and we know that Christ will forever be a man, a human. And so we have him forever. And in fact, our little planet will be the center of the universe when Christ dwells with us. In Revelation chapter 21 explains that in more detail. Sister in the back.
Not only are we blessed with funds at times, but we are blessed in many other ways.
Absolutely.
I'm on a limited budget now that I'm retired. And I was a stay-at-home mom for a long time, so I didn't qualify for sustentation.
Yeah.
But I've given my time.
That's correct.
My neighbor needed help with his child. And so I said I'd pick her up off the bus. Uh-huh. He wanted to pay me, and I said, no, that's okay. I can do this for you.
Amen.
And one of the nights was Friday evening, and so I wouldn't take money anyway.
Right.
Somebody started giving me some food that was left over from a situation. And every week they give me different foods that, you know, so it's not financial, but it is a blessing to me. And somebody else has offered to do, there was something else that I needed done. So we are blessed in other ways.
Yes.
Other than monetary.
Absolutely.
God takes care of us.
That's right. And so, you know, when God says, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, and a knowledge of God more than burnt offering, when we recognize who God is and that he will provide for us, then we're no longer afraid to give, right? We recognize that he's going to take care of us, and he wants us to co-labor with him. He wants us to work with him to bless others so that we too could share in the blessing of being a part of that. Because surely God could just send the angels to do it, but he wants us to get an experience in the blessing of seeing souls won to the kingdom, seeing people being able to eat, people not being in a dormitory with dirt on the floor, but, you know, having a good environment to live in. So God wants us to be involved and be invested in the process of soul winning. Because we know heaven is not the same. We talked about this before, right? Heaven is in Mayday mode, right? It's in recovery mode, trying to help this planet. So we who are children of God should be in that same mode of going out there and helping others. And I believe that's what the first angel's message is about. When it says to fear God and give glory to him, it's talking about this idea of making earth a better place for other people. It's not just in how you worship, but because you worship the Creator, you're trying to bless people and provide something better. And it may be in something as simply as helping to get a kid off the bus safely so that they're not, you know, in harm's way. You know, and God will put it on our heart what exactly we need to do. We're going to finish up here with Mark chapter 12. If I can have a volunteer, because this story is a beautiful one. Mark chapter 12, verses 41 to 44, the widow's mite. God takes note of our offering. This is, I believe, Wednesday's lesson. All right, who is going to read that? Mark chapter 12, verse 41 to 44. Brother Daniel again. Thank you, sir.
And Jesus sat over against the treasury and beheld how the people cast money into the treasury, and many that were rich cast in much. And there came a certain poor widow, and she threw in two mites, which make a farthing. And he called unto his disciples and said unto them, Verily I say unto you that this poor widow has cast in more than all they which have cast into the treasury. For all they did cast in their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all that she had, even all her living.
Thank you so much. Wow, what faith. right? And I went ahead and I read the commentary on this, and I believe the lesson brought it out too, but I wanted to share it with you guys. It says, Jesus said to the poor widow, Jesus said, off the poor widow, she has cast in more than they all, the rich had bestowed from their abundance, many of them to be seen and honored by men. Their large donations had deprived them of no comfort or even luxury. They had required no sacrifice and could not be compared in value with the widow's mite. And he talks about the motive above the amount. It is the motive that gives character to our acts, stamping them with ignominy or with the high moral worth, not the great things which every eye sees and every tongue praises does God account most precious. The little duties cheerfully done, the little gifts which makes no show and which to human eyes may appear worthless, often stand highest in his sight. A heart of faith and love is dearer to God than the most costly gift. The poor widow gave her living to do the little she did. She deprived herself of food or in order to give those two mites to the cause she loved, and she did it in faith, believing that her Heavenly Father would not overlook her great need. It was this unselfish spirit and childlike faith that won the Savior's commendation. Among the poor, there are many who long to show their gratitude to God, to His grace and truth. They greatly desire to share with their more prosperous brethren in sustaining His service. These souls should not be repulsed. Let them lay up their mites in the bank of heaven. It given from the heart, filled with love of God, these seeming trifling become consecrated gifts, priceless offerings, which God smiles upon and blesses much. All right, so thank you guys for being a part of the lesson. So remember that we're more blessed to give than to receive. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for such great examples in the Bible. We see examples of things not to do, and we see examples of things that we should do. Plus, we have the testimony of believers in this room who shared from their mind and from their experiences as well. Help us to be a cheerful giver today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. So glad everyone's here today. Our first song is going to be 608, Faith is the Victory.
Thank you.
next song is going to be 612, Onward Christian Soldier. Is going to be 294, Power in the Blood.
Power in the blood.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Good to see you, all of you. Those that are watching from home, welcome to our church. This morning when I came into church, I was glad that no one asked me to sign the visitor book because this is my first Sabbath this year coming to our church. Been out a lot. I was just kind of calculating this morning. I already stayed 20 nights this month alone in hotels. So I've been traveling a lot. Been to, I think, 6 states already. And looks like my travel is going to pick up more month of March and things like that. So I am happy to be here, to say the least, and to see many of you here in attendance this morning. Just one correction in our bulletin. It's not a correction, last minute change. Person that is going to do special music today, Ashley Rich, she's not feeling well this morning. And so Melinda Wirtz volunteered to do the special music last minute, so thank you for that. And we have some announcements this morning. First, I received several thank you cards from the students at Highland View Academy that our church has been sponsoring, and I'm going to put that in the bulletin board for you to see. So they sent a thank you card to our church for sponsoring them. And also for Sabbath school, it's not too late for those that want to start reading Conflict of the Ages series or Bible or memory verse marking. All the information is outside, right, left side of the our CMR box. There's a box that pertaining to all the Sabbath school things that we're doing, so that I encourage you to do that. Several new people started this year, so that was really happy to see that happening. Couple announcement that I would like to highlight this morning, Bible marking and training class right at 2 o'clock in the fellowship hall after the potluck, so I encourage you to attend for that. New fellowship hall, fellowship dinner policy is on your bulletin. We were going to start that next week. So please pay attention and read that. Basically, we're going to lock up the doors that leading to sanctuary at 1 o'clock from fellowship hall for security reasons. So please read that for your information. We have a second reading of many membership-related second reading. I'm going to read that, and at the end, we'll take the one vote for all those membership transfers. So we have Richard and Judy Rogers from Frederick to Williamsport. They are there, back there, just waved so that we can look right there. And Enoch Filho from the Waldorf SDA Church to Williamsport Church. Enoch? Okay. And Myra Alexandra Ruiz from the Hagerstown Spanish Church to Williamsport Church. Okay. And Martha Irene Sequoino Torres, Martha, from Hagerstown Spanish Church to Williamsport Church. I know Martha is here today. Sound booth, yep. And then Dare and Cheryl Harvison from our church to New Market SDA Church, transferring out. And Katarina Burkett from Williamsport Church to Athens SDA Church. So we have a lot of membership transfer. So anyone would like to move to acceptance of the membership transfer? Okay, any seconds? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, against? Thank you for approving that. We'll continue with our church service at this point.
Our invocation song is in your bulletin and on the screen, and as we offer this up as a prayer, sing it with your heart, not just with your mouth. Lord Jesus, we have come here to worship and to grow. Bless these moments, send your Spirit, heal our souls. May the oneness
May our hearts be filled with Jesus and our lives be lived with grace. Lord Jesus, we have come here to worship and to grow. Bless these moments, send your Spirit, heal our souls. May the oneness that you will for us be lived out in this place. May our hearts be filled with Jesus and our lives be lived with grace. Amen. Amen.
Opening hymn will be 343, I Sing of My Redeemer.
Please stand. A couple weeks ago when I went to work, I was basically wearing the same suit that I'm wearing today. And as soon as I walked into office, my assistant made a comment. Said, hey, you're wearing a color of Ukraine. And I didn't realize, and I wasn't really intending to be that, but at that moment realized that the war in Ukraine is still going on. And the millions of people are suffering. And thousands, hundreds and thousands of people lost their lives because someone is
power hungry and wants to, you know, dominate weaker nations and things like that. And so a lot of people are suffering around the world as we meet this morning. And so I would like to remind us to remember those that around the world that are suffering. And also I would like to invite you to pray for our schools. We are part of the constituency of Mount Etna Elementary School, and also Highlandview Academy is part of our school in Chesapeake Conference. And trying to operate schools is not easy. And there's a lot of things that goes into operating schools, and teachers and principals and staff, they don't have a lot of budget. They have a lot of responsibilities and things that need to happen. And so I'd like us to remember our schools and all the teachers and staff and students, uplift them so that through our schools, we can spread God's love and teach them how to love Jesus as young age and for them to stay in our church. So this morning, I would like to invite anyone that will have a special prayer request that you want to bring to the Lord, come to the front and kneel with us as we pray at this time.
Our Father in heaven, just thank you for the opportunity to be here in your house this morning. Thank you for all the blessings that you've poured out on us, our beautiful families and children. We just thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for providing a way for us to be able to go to heaven, Lord, and for coming and dying to save us. Lord, there's so much suffering and pain in this world, and we think of those around the world that are suffering, and we uplift them to you this morning. And we thank you, Lord, that you're able to bring good through suffering and persecution, and that all things work together for good for those that love God. We just claim that promise this morning. And we just, we also thank you for all the teachers and the hardworking staff at our Christian schools and for the opportunity that we have to send our kids to have a Christian education. We just ask that you pour out your blessing on our schools. And we thank you for Pastor Stander and ask for a special blessing on him this morning as he brings your word to us. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
When I opened our church bulletin this morning, I saw that we're over the budget, and that is good, and I'm praising God that our members are cheerful givers. In my line of work, when we say over the budget, that's not a good thing, but in our case, we're over the budget, meaning our giving is more than what we budgeted for. So thank you so much, all of you, for being generous giver for his work in our area, in our church. So thank you so much. And today our offering is going to be for Chesapeake Advance. We have a video to share before that.
When was the last time you received God's call to do something special for him? Are you making yourself available to him? When God called Delmar and Nati and their 3-year-old daughter, Clara, to serve as missionaries in Albania, they knew that living in a foreign country would stretch their comfort zone. and it didn't take long to learn some of the challenges they would face as they worked to bring the gospel to Albania. For years, Albania had banned religion. Even today, religion isn't a priority for most. As a result, there are only about 120 Adventists there. To grow the church, the family was assigned to serve in the city of Korcha. They had great plans, but few were interested in Bible studies, despite their efforts. Delmar was discouraged. All their effort wasn't paying off. Then, at the peak of Delmar's frustration, the family received a call to pastor a large church in Brazil. The offer seemed perfect, but Nati wasn't so sure.
I came and talked to my wife. You know, we got a call to go back to Brazil. What do you think? We're not doing anything here anyway. Why we don't accept that and we just leave? And that's it. She looked to me. She said, do you think that we did everything that we could here in Albania? Do you really think that it's time for us to leave this place? She said, I personally think that we should stay, that the Lord has something prepared for us here. And maybe he wants to teach us something here, and he still wants to use us.
So they declined the offer from Brazil and prayed to God to instruct and use them to advance with his ministry. Delmar and Nati noticed many children in their neighborhood. They thought that maybe working with children was a good place to start. The couple prepared a volleyball court and invited the children to come and play. The kids started coming to the churchyard to play, and thus, they got to know Delmar and Nati. Soon, the churchyard was full of kids. Now, they just needed to get them inside the church. Angela, one of the church members, brought her friend, Fatih John, to join the game. Fatih John and Delmar started talking about God, and then they began studying the Bible together. Delmar invited Fatih John to be part of the youth group. Great, Fatih John said. I want to help these kids, to serve this community. Soon, he was involved, and the kids loved him. Fatih John helped bring the youth together, and also grew an interest in God's word. Delmar was thrilled to baptize Fatih John. His first baptism in Albania, the church's youth group has added many new faces. The church's center of influence is growing as Delmar and Nati continue to serve on the front lines of Albania. As you worship God with your tithes and promise, regular and systematic offerings, thank him for the opportunity to support missionary families like Delmar and Nati. May we put our desires last and God first.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for many blessings that you have given to each one of us. And this morning, as we return tithe and offerings, that our funds can go further to spread the gospel message news to everyone around the world, especially those places that has not reached your message. And thank you so much. We pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Thank you.
Last couple Sabbaths, we went to a new church that we've never been to before. And I really got to appreciate our Williamsport Church Kids Box. And during the church service, there was a children's offering, children's story section, and kids were going around and collecting offering. When I opened my wallet, I saw $5 bear and $20 bears. I said, oh. I wish that I had a Williamsport Kids Box. I was able to give $5 one for the one kids to the children's offering, and I couldn't have the courage to pull out the $20 bear. So this morning we're going to be collecting children's offering for children's come around, and we are very fortunate that we have our own money that we can hand out to the kids. So please be generous for today's offering, and offering will be used for the student aid.
Good morning, children. Happy Sabbath. How are you doing? Who of you can tell me what is there on the screen? That is a baby. I told you last time that we have a new addition to the family, my sister's son. It's her firstborn. And the problem is every day I'm overloaded with videos and photos. And we are all still having baby fever. Do you know what is baby fever? I get sick. No, that's when we get sick, not they. We get sick with love for babies. Isn't that cute? That was taken this week as like we are fuffing the whole day. Oh, cute. Who of you can tell me who is that on the picture? Take a guess. There's Joshua, who, anyone else? Simone, who else? That's me. I had to take a re-look. Is that really me? I thought I was more beautiful. I remembered myself much more beautiful than this, but that is me, a photo, don't lie. But I can tell you, I'm becoming more beautiful over time. And so that is me with my grandmother. She was too happy. Every year, they lived at the sea and we lived north of the country. And so she sent me a special knitted jersey every year through the mail. It was always very special. Now guess who is that? Who can tell me? That is me with my sister. When she was a baby, you remember when Simone was introduced to Joshua? Now this is my sister introduced to me. And so do you think I loved my sister?
Yeah.
Oh, I loved my sister. I always wanted to protect her. And so, of course, she was growing too. There she is at a few months old. And then there came a baby brother a few years after that. That is my sister with our baby brother. Yes. And so he was growing over time. And so this last few weeks, we are just reminiscing about our childhood, how cute we were, how cute babies is. And my wife doesn't like that conversation. I don't know why. Any case, who of you can tell me who is this? Yes, it's me with my sister. So I want to tell you a story. We were dressing up for what? For church. It was Sabbath that day, and I was very excited. We had a very special church, and that was called the Spring Seventh-day Adventist Church. It was very similar to HVA's building on the campus. And I just loved the church. Guess who was my Sabbath school teacher? My mom. She was the primary teacher, and my sister went to kindergarten, and it was just fun at church. We had a lot of fun activities, and I really enjoyed the music. And then there was a lot of programs afterward. And so the one evening, we had a social at the church, and it was a fun social. There was a lot of activities. And then they, at the youth room, they showed a movie to the youth. And then some of the youth, there were some adults there, and some of the youth said to some of the children, come and watch the movie. And I think I was like six at the time. And I was thinking to myself, and then I said, okay, I will go and watch it. That was the mistake of my life. It was, I won't mention what it was, but it was about a dingo in Australia. And I had nightmares for years to come. I made a wrong decision, even at that small age. I want to ask you a question today. Is it important what we choose to watch on TV? Is it important what we choose to listen to the music? Is it important to choose what we put in our mouth? Yes. If we put the wrong things in our mind, if we put the wrong things in our mouth, it will affect us for years to come. That night, what I put in my mind with that movie, and it was a sad thing that happened at the church, was it affected me for a long, long time. And so I want to encourage you boys and girls, wherever you go, always make the right decision. Ask yourself, can this help me or will this affect me for the negative, for the bad? Will it affect me for the worse? And so I want to have this principle in my life. If I want to do something for Jesus, I want to be that little boy dressing up for church, excited to learn about who in Sabbath school? About Jesus. And I want to be that little boy that says, everything I do should glorify God. Amen? And so I want to encourage you as you go to your seats, as you listen to this sermon, let's make better and wise choices in our life. That whatever we put in our body, if it's in our mind or physical food or whatever we drink or music, that it will be the good and the better. Amen? To the glory of Jesus. May God bless you. Thank you.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading will be from Psalm 46:1. I will be reading from the CBS version. God is our refuge and strength, a helper who is always found in times of trouble.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, amen. There's no better place to be. So we are starting a new sermon series this, let me say, quarter, for the next few weeks. And it's called Strength for the End Time. I want to ask you a few questions this morning. I want to see if we are on the same page. The first question is, do you think that we are living in the last days? Yes. Do you think that we need a special portion of grace for the last days? Yes. Absolutely. We are living in a time that was not before on this planet. It is a time like never before. It is a time that the prophets actually look forward to and said, like Daniel chapter 12, a time of trouble such as never was before. That is the time we are going to enter. And so the Bible is telling us that we need strength that we don't possess at the moment. And so over the next few weeks, we're going to look at health. Now, when people speak about health, many people freak out. You know, when you touch someone's money or their plate, they get angry. Do you agree with me? You know, they don't touch my plate. Don't touch my cup and don't touch my purse. And I won't touch anything, so don't stress. Okay, you can relax. We're going to only look at the word and inspiration. And we're going to see the positive side and what God wants to do in our life. Amen? And what we should do with the help of the Holy Spirit. So today is introduction and it's titled, You Need to Build Your Strength. Now, I need to put the disclaimer. The information provided in this presentation is for informational purposes only. It's not intended to diagnose, treat, or give medical advice. The speaker is not a licensed medical professional, and any personal choices made based on the information provided in this presentation are the sole responsibility of the individual. The speaker cannot be held liable, amen, for any actions or consequences resulting from the use of this information. I'm going to share with you in another presentation about you need to drink a lot of water. If you're going to drink 5 gallons, that's your choice. I'm not going to be held liable, amen. So I need to put this on the screen. So we're going to start with the first chapter today, and it's called The Gift of Health. And so, a gift. What is a gift? A gift is something you don't what? You don't earn. It's something that you receive, and you didn't work for it. You can't pay for it. And health is a gift given to us by God to do what? To serve Him to our full potential. Usually, most people on this planet, not everyone, but most people are born with relatively good health. Yeah, there may be some issues here and there, but most of us can walk, we can talk, we can move, you know, we can feel, we have senses, you know, we have relatively good health, and that is a gift. We could have been all born zombies. We could have all been born dead. We could have been all been born without any form or substance, and
No, we are all born in this beautiful bodies we are all in. We are all born with this gift of health. It is from God. The Bible says, and it is a good thing to receive wealth from God and the good health to enjoy it. Listen now, to enjoy your work and accept your lot in life, this is indeed a what? It is a gift from God. The Bible says health is a gift from God, Ecclesiastes chapter 5, 19. And so here you are born, you have been given a gift that is specially from the throne of grace. Question, if you receive a special gift from someone, what do? With a gift. Man, poor Amazon. I've had such a lot of returns this past Christmas, it's not true. Millions of gifts were returned to Amazon. People rather want the money than the gift. Now, years ago, you couldn't do it. If I buy my son a new vehicle, Joshua, don't get ideas. I'm not going to do it. But if I buy him a vehicle, some people already telling me, he's going to be 16 one of these days. You get him a vehicle. I'm not on that page at the moment. But let's say I buy him a vehicle. It's a gift. He does not deserve it. I can tell you that. He's a good boy, but I can't see children deserving a vehicle. But in any case, I started with a bicycle. My dad never gave me a vehicle. In any case, so let's say I buy him a vehicle and he says, oh, wow, wonderful gift. Actually, the mileage is on zero. I'm going to take it for a spin. And he just speeds here 90 to 100 miles down this street. Do you think that's responsible? Do you think he's really treating the gift like I intended him to treat it? No. I want to share with you this thought and this thinking, because when we're going to speak about health, some of you may think, but you know, I have these challenges in my life and these health conditions, and you know, I feel uncomfortable with you speaking about all this health. I will never be there. Beloved, we are all being born in a broken world, amen? And so when I speak about health, it is to the best possibility that you can achieve in your life with God's grace, with all the challenges you may have. We receive our bodies as gifts from God. Sickness, listen now, reminds us how remarkable it is to have what? Bodies that work. Even sick people, people with diseases, have bodies that work. In the gift of a body, we receive the privilege of walking, growing, eating, aging, and laughing. And maybe someone don't even have the privilege of walking, but most people can laugh. Most people can eat or take something in. That is a privilege. Even that is a privilege. And we all have the privilege of aging. I know that doesn't sound like a privilege, but it is. We are experiencing something that God wants to bring our way. Even healing from the small stuff, let's say you have a cold, you know, the sniffles, is a marvel that involves multiple systems of our body. Isn't that amazing? Human bodies are glorious. The fact that our joints stay well-oiled and our lungs keep breathing decade after decade, for some of us, way past warranty, is a wonder, a commonplace miracle. Isn't that amazing? I won't mention names, but we have some of us here that are past 80, and you walk and move about, it's like, wow. Can you imagine for 80 years those joints keeping up, the lungs are still breathing? That's just a miracle. It's a gift from God. The human body is more spectacular and intricate than anything else in the world. We take it for granted until it doesn't work. Isn't that the case? Especially young people. When we are sick, we also remember the glory for which we are made, and we recall that our health is a gift. When you lie there on the back of your, you know, there on the back of your back, there on the bed, and you just think about your terrible situation, immediately you think of the good times. Immediately you're supposed to appreciate health in a new way. It's not just any deity, it's the God of the universe, it's the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not what? Beloved, you don't belong to yourself. I hear this every time I speak with someone about health. It's my body, I can do what I want. If you're a Christian and you know that Jesus redeemed you with his blood, you don't belong to yourself. You cannot say, I can do what I want, what I please, leave me alone. You cannot say that. You are not your own. The Bible says, for you are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Your body, your mind, your spirit belongs to God. Wow. And then under this chapter, the gift of health, stewards. We are stewards of this gift of health. Health should be preserved and not neglected. We have a duty, not only knowing that this body belongs to God, but that I'm a steward of this very body, and that God will ask me in the judgment one day, what did you do with this body that I entrusted to you? I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present what? Your thinking. No, your bodies. A living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that he may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. God is calling us to a standard where we know that we don't only belong to God and this body is his temple, but that we will surrender this body to him and say, God, what you want me to do in this body and with this body, I will do. I will preserve this body. That is why it says a sacrifice. The only way you can preserve yourself, your health, your body, is to sacrifice it to Jesus. That seems like an oxymoron. That is the way we do it. You see, for many years, people have looked at health in the wrong way. They see it as do's and don'ts. No, it is a spiritual mandate. It is about surrendering to Jesus. Our second chapter, end time diseases. We are living in the end time, beloved, when disease and sickness are increasing. Am I making this up? No. Infectious diseases are on the rise. Let me show you the prophecy before I show you the fulfillment. The Bible says in Matthew 24:7, Jesus says, for nation shall rise against what? Do we see it at the moment? Oh, absolutely. And kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be what? Famines and what? Pestilences. These are infectious diseases, and Jesus prophesied in the last days this will be part of the package. Not just earthquakes and earthquakes in diverse places, not just famines, not just wars, but pestilences. This is where we are at. Maranatha, page 216, it says Satan will bring disease and disaster. That is in this future we are now stepping into. Until populous cities are reduced to ruin and desolation. No Hollywood movie can portray the desolation cities will experience by pestilence, by infectious disease. We have seen nothing yet. The prophecy says very clearly it is going to be rampant throughout the world. You better preserve your health. Amen. Page 174 of the same book says, in the last scenes of this earth's history, war will rage. There will be what? Pestilence, plague, and famine. Beloved, this is the time we are moving into. And this then just makes sense to me why God wants to have us healthy. How can we go through a time like this if we don't have health in our lives? Can you see the relevance? Now, this is not just about prophecy. Do we see any fulfillment today about this? Absolutely. I don't have to tell you what happened the past 3 years. It's now exactly 3 years. It has been the most crazy time of my life, and I believe most people's lives. It has affected the whole world to such an extent. Everything is almost different. People are different, and many are not with us anymore. I'm going to share with you this study in a scientific journal, Infectious Disease in an Era of Global Change. The abstract says, in this review, we consider the extent to which these recent global changes have increased the risk. What happened?
increase the risk of infectious disease outbreaks, even as improved sanitation and access to healthcare have resulted in considerable progress worldwide. And so there's all these graphs that are quite amazing. And so this one is about urbanization. Do you know that 50 years ago, most of the population lived in rural areas? It totally changed. It is now in the urban areas, and cities are growing faster, and the rural areas are basically getting more empty. And the more people are packed together in cities, the more there's infectious diseases. It's just a law of nature. And the more things are going on in the world with climatic, technological, demographic change, there's more disease. Let me just show you this in a moment. Here's this chart, the mapping of travel. In 1933, the chart above, those blue lines were the few, were the pathways basically where people traveled all over the world, where the major routes were, okay? Just look at almost 100 years later, 2020. The world is blue with the traveling all over the world from city to city, town to town. And so you can just see for yourself, it's logical that infectious diseases will spread much more easier than before. And so we can see it. I don't have really time to go, my time is running, into the population. But the population, they say in the next 100 years, is going to be so incredible in all those red areas in the bottom map that only the people in the black areas will be spared any infectious diseases. That's basically in the desert in Australia and then in the Northern Pole. That's crazy. Any case, so that is where we are at with the world currently. And then we see lifestyle diseases on the rise. What does prophecy say about this? The Bible actually prophesies this, okay? Not only infectious diseases. The Bible says, this is Jesus prophesying about our time. Likewise also, as it was in the days of what? Lot. They did what? Eat, they drank. Now you're going to see that why Jesus includes what they did in the days of Lot. They ate, they drank. Why did Jesus say that? Is that just, you know, he just wanted to put some activity into the prophecy? Or is there meaning to the activity in the prophecy? There's meaning. I'll show it to you now. They bought, they sold, they planted, they built it. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and did what? Destroyed them all. And so the story of Lot is a type of the end of the world. And Jesus said, in those days of Sodom and Lot, they ate and they drank. Now let me unpack this in Ezekiel 16:49. The Bible says, behold, this was the iniquity. This is the sin of Sodom. What's the sin? Pride. We have a lot of that going on. Fullness of bread. What? Did you hear that? Fullness of what? Fullness of bread and abundance of idleness. The sin of Sodom, except pride, was that they had such an abundance of food, most of them became obese. And abundance of idleness, they were even more sick and obese because they were lazy, didn't do anything. They just had parties and festivals and every day revolved around food. They lived to eat. That was the sin of Sodom. Jesus says, before he comes, this will be in the world again. Okay, and now it just makes sense why Jesus is prophesying that there will be lifestyle diseases before he comes. Do we see this fulfilled before our very eyes today? Brothers and sisters, this is just incredible. The number one death we see occur, especially in this country, is heart disease. You know, it's cardiovascular diseases. We can just see from 1990 to 2019 how it is just increasing, and it's increasing even more now. It is all over the world, and that is a lifestyle disease mostly. Mostly a lifestyle disease is cancer. Yes, there's other concerns too, but mostly a lifestyle disease, cancer. And what do we find from 1990 to 2016? It is just increasing globally, all the types of cancers you can think of. And, you know, there's many graphs that I can show you. You know, over the world, in the UK, even mouth cancer. Everything is just rising. Now, there may be other factors, but most agree that most of these cancers are lifestyle related. We can even see from 2002 to 2018, there's a rise in cases and there's a rise in cancer deaths. The same with diabetes. Diabetes is growing rapidly. You can see there from 1958 to 2015, it is just spiking. Can you see? It is just climbing. And this is just shocking. You can look graph after graph with any of these lifestyle diseases, mostly. Let me just add, mostly. We're specifically speaking about type 2. It's just the upward trend. Here we see from 1980 to 2014, it's the upward trend. Globally, can you see that? Globally, especially in certain places that I won't mention here. Okay, then we see, okay, this is the fact, this is what is going on. And because this is going on, are we living in the end? Or let me ask it the other way around. Is the world health-wise getting better? Isn't that strange? Because, you know, we all know that science many times and healthcare is getting better, but our diseases are not getting better. Something is wrong. Jesus said, this is going to happen. And I will show you in the next presentation that it's actually prophesied as, and I just want to, you to see this link. As wickedness is increasing, inspiration says disease is increasing. The world is becoming more evil and dark and alienated from God than ever before. Christian countries are literally becoming secularized and turning their back on God. And the more this happens, the more there is sickness and disease because they are living apart from God and His health laws. It is as simple as that. And no matter the best care you may have, it will keep on spiking and increasing. This is the society we are living in. This is the world we are living in. And it's only going to get worse. Which means we should be strong and healthy. It's just logical. God needs us strong and healthy in the end time to bring His message to the world. Do we have a mandate and a mission? Do we have a message to bring to the world? Absolutely. If we have a message, how on earth can we deliver the message if we are just sick in bed the whole time? Do you think we will be able to do it successfully? No. Impossible. Do you think that the Postal Service of the United States are in good working order when there's no trucks moving around and about delivering the packages because all of them are broken down? The system cannot work. The message cannot be delivered. The package cannot be delivered. So we need to be strong and healthy, not being broken down. That is why Matthew 24, 13 says, but he that shall do what? Endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. I just want to put in brackets again here. Beloved, I know some of us have real health struggles. There is no condemnation in this message, really. Even in my worst situation, God can use me. Amen? Just a smile to someone can reach someone for Jesus. But I'm looking at the overall picture here, and God, most of you have relatively good health. God may be speaking to you today. And God is telling us, in the end time, it will call for strength. It will call for endurance to go through what is needed, and then to bring His message. So first of all, we need to be enduring and strong to go through these things. And then the next verse comes saying that those people will bring the gospel to the world. Can you see that? It just makes sense. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be what? Preached in all the world for a witness. A what? a witness. I will leave it at that. Unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Revelation 18:11 is verse 1 is a wonderful prophecy. What is going to happen when God pours out the Holy Spirit in latter rain power? And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with what? With his glory. Beloved, just think of that. Receiving the power of the Holy Spirit. Isn't that going to be amazing? Now, some people think they can live as they want to, but they will receive the power of the Holy Spirit and that will just change everything. Let's go back to the first principles. Always go back to the first principles. We saw that health is a gift. Amen. We saw that God gave us a body to be his temple. Amen. And then we saw that God is asking us to surrender this body to his service. The only people, and I'm not saying only people in perfect health. That's not my thing today, so don't get me wrong. But only people whose bodies are surrendered to Jesus will be able to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Can you see that? If you are living in rebellion, don't tell me what to do. How can God fill you with his glory if you are not surrendered? Okay? So don't get this backwards. This is about surrendering. This is not about works. Many people have gotten this wrong over many years about health. It's about what you do, what you do, what you do. No. Health is about surrendering to Jesus. He will lead you. Don't let people lead you. Ministry of Healing, page 397 and onward says, the human family, formed in the image of God, God desires them to become all that he has made it possible. Can you see this high and mighty dream and vision of God for us? For them to be and to do their very best with the powers he has given them. And yes, some of us have real challenges, but to do the very best within your capability, okay? So when you surrender to Jesus, he will do whatever he can with even the weaknesses of your body. The highest of all sciences is the science of what? It's the science of what? Soul saving. This is the highest science. But in order to get to that science of soul saving, we need education. And I want you to see this connection. For the accomplishment of this work, a comprehensive education is needed. What is this education? True education includes the whole being. It enables us to make the best use of what? Brain, bone, and muscle of body, mind, and heart. The faculties of the mind as the higher powers are to rule the kingdom of the body. And so God wants to equip us and educate us so that we can use our whole being in his service. Can you see? Again, it's about complete surrender. Then in this end time scenario where we are finding ourselves, besides that God wants us to be strong and healthy, God wants to give us a healing ministry. You don't have to be a nurse or a doctor. Praise God for them, but you don't have to be one to touch someone else's life. Part of spreading God's message will be to help people with their physical health. We're going to go into a time, and we're already entering it, where the world will become so sick that only if we help them, they will be able to listen to the gospel. I hope you hear me today. Testimonies, volume 1, 489 says, Sabbath keepers who are looking for the soon appearing of their Savior should be the last to manifest a lack of interest in this great work of health reform. Men and women must be what? Instructed. There's education. I wish to tell you that soon there will be no work done in ministerial lines, but what? Medical missionary work. One of these days it's going to be impossible for me to preach and to really reach people. We can't send out pamphlets. People will be too sick. We will need to go to them. I will need to go to them and help them practically with their health. And then they will listen. We have come to a time when every member of the church should take hold of medical missionary work. The world is a laser house filled with victims of both physical and spiritual disease. The light God has given on health reform is for our salvation and the salvation of the world. So God is giving us a very special message of health so that we can be saved. We're not meaning saved in the kingdom. That we can be saved from infectious diseases. Doesn't mean you will never get sick, but that you can be strong overall. And then that you can help others in the world to also see that light and to be strong and more healthy. Last quote on this topic. As religious aggression subverts the liberties of our nation, those who would stand for freedom of conscience will be placed in unfavorable positions. For their own sake, they should, while they have opportunity, question, do we have opportunity at this very moment? Yeah, I'm inviting you to come to every sermon, please. When you cannot listen to it online, this is critical information for our time. While you have opportunity, you need to take the opportunity to become intelligent in regard to disease, its causes, prevention, and what? And cure. God wants His people to see the basics of the simplicity of health so that we can help others in a time where it will be about liberty and about issues that are prophetic in our country. There will be suffering ones, listen now, plenty of them. Are we going to see a lot of sick people around us? Desperately sick, plenty of them. Who will need what? I want you to see this. It won't be a time for us to cower down in our houses to try and save ourselves. It's going to be time to go out of our houses and to try and help those who are in need. Not only among those of our own faith, but largely among those who know not the truth. And this is how God is going to reach the world. The shortness of time demands an energy that has not been aroused among those who claim to believe the present truth. May God give us a lot of wisdom on this subject, because only God can help us. I want to end today, and I pray that you see the true picture here, because people get very nervous and sensitive when it comes to health. But beloved, here is the fact. It's an act of worship. First of all, living abundantly. To live abundantly and stand strong, we need to build our physical, mental, and spiritual health. John chapter 10, verse 10 says, "The thief cometh not but for what? To steal, to kill, and to do what? Destroy. I am come that they might what? Have what? Life. And that they might have it more abundantly." God wants us to be strong in our spiritual health. But God wants us to be strong in our physical health too. And when I'm going to speak in this series about physical health, I'm including mental health, etc. And He wants us to have abundant lives of health far as possible within this body with its sin on this planet. Then body and spirit. You know, many people don't see this correlation. There's a direct connection between our spiritual and physical health. People say, you know, what I do in my body has nothing to do with my spirituality. Really? There's a direct correlation. The one affects the other. The Bible says, not me, the Bible says, 3 John 2, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest do what? Prosper and be in what? Health, even as thy what? Thy soul prospereth." Is there a relation between your spiritual health and your physical health, according to Scripture? Totally. Yes, even a more direct verse. Proverbs chapter 17, 22. "A merry heart doeth good like..." Wow. "A merry heart doeth good like a medicine." Your mind, your emotions, your spirit, your spiritual health have a direct impact on your physical health, and vice versa. But a broken spirit dries the what? The bones. There's even some studies confirming just that verse. But that's a story for another day. want to share with you Testimonies for the Church, volume 4, page 1661. The relation which exists between the mind and the body is very intimate. When one is affected, the other sympathizes. Isn't that amazing? If you're going to feel bad, you're going to feel bad physically too, vice versa. And so when you are active and you live healthy, it's going to affect your mind and your spirituality. Let me just put it very simply. Let's say you're very sick, you feel bad, and you just want to stay in bed. You feel like you're going to just die. And there you lie. Do you feel like praying? Do you feel like praying? Not really. Do you feel you are able to do an intense Bible study? No. Can you see that it affects your spiritual health? Even if you don't want to, it affects your spiritual health. And we see this today in research and science. In the National Library of Medicine, yes, an article published, mind-body research moves towards the mainstream. A few years back, it was just here and there. Now it is in the mainstream. It becomes fact now. And we have known this for thousands of years in the Bible. And as a church for more than 100 years. More scientific evidence for the mind-body connection in Idea Health and Fitness Association. And then there's this journal, Psychological Health, Well-being, and the Mind-Heart-Body Connection, a scientific statement from the American Heart Association. If there's one you need to read, go and read this. It's just amazing. It's just amazing. It's really mainstream these days. And then, to end this all off, worship. Maintaining your health is not what? Extreme. I am going to emphasize this every sermon. Looking after your health, building your health, maintaining your health, wanting to be healthy is not extreme. Amen. It is not extreme. Actually, it's an act of worship and devotion. The Bible says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Hello, reasonable service. Is that extreme? It's the opposite of extreme. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Beloved, that is not extreme to want to know God's will for your life. This is what God wants from us. It is our Christian duty. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 31 says, whether therefore you eat or drink, whatsoever you do, do all to what? The glory of God. You're going to see, we will still study this, that when I have a meal, I do that meal to the glory of God. When I sit at the table, even at a restaurant, that is an act of worship. I'm either going to worship myself to gratify myself, or it will be an act of worship to worship God, thanking Him for His bounty and blessing, and that He can preserve my body for His glory. Can you see it? This is where God wants us to be. This is an act of worship. So I'm going to end with Jesus, and I want you to see where the focus is. Malachi 4:2 says, but unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with what? Healing in His wings. Do you know that Jesus is the Son of Righteousness? We're going to see, don't miss next week, that the Son is, we cannot have health without the Son. It is impossible. And so the Son is the building block for all health on this planet. It's the building block for all energy and for everything on this planet. You can't do it without the Son. But Jesus is trying to describe Himself as the Son of Righteousness with healing in His wings. Jesus, listen now, is our health. If I am against health, I'm against Jesus, period. Jesus is my health. And you shall go forth and grow up as calves of the stall. Jesus wants us to have a good life, amen, as far as possible, but with His blessing, because He is our health. Let me just demonstrate it in our last verse for today. God is our refuge and God is our strength. Who's our strength? Let me ask you this question again. Are we living in the end time? Do we need strength for the end time? Who is our strength for the end time? Jesus Christ. God Himself. He is our strength, which means He is our health. So, beloved, I invite you to come with me on this journey and that we can see that just the simplicity of it, there's no judgment, no extreme. It's about surrender and worship, that God can work more fully in our lives and prepare us for what is lying ahead, and that He can use us more fully. Amen. May God bless us. Amen.
Please stand for our closing hymn, 625 Higher Ground.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I onward bound, Lord, let thy feet on higher ground, or lift me up and I shall stand, thy faith on heaven's stables out, a higher plane than I have found, Lord, let thy feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears to stay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand, thy faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found, Lord, let my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled, for faith has taught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand, thy faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, let my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still a prey to heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and I shall stand, by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, let my feet on higher ground.
Did you hear the words? Lord, lift me up. Who is doing the lifting? Jesus Christ. Oh, Father, thank you for your word and thank you for Jesus, who is our health and healing, even our divine physician when we are sick. Oh, Father, you have given us a body. You have given us so many blessings, even for those of us with challenges. And Father, I just pray that you will show us the way to live more abundantly so that we can honor and glorify you more fully. O Father, may you teach us to surrender, that Jesus may lift us up. I pray, Father, for everyone here today, that you may prepare us for what is lying ahead. We've been through some testing phase this last 3 years, but Father, it is only the beginning. I just pray that you may give us faith, not fear, that we may actually have an excitement, because we're going to see what God is going to do in and through us. Oh, Father, may we keep holding on to your hand, and may there be higher ground in our lives. May the love of the Father be with us now. May Jesus' grace be sufficient for us. And may the Holy Spirit lead us deeper into surrender. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.